Welcome to the Michigan Man Podcast on Wolverine Sports Radio, a member of the VSporto Network, and in partnership with SB Nation's Maize and Brew, for Wolverine fans from coast to coast. Go Blue, and welcome to the show. I'm your host, Mike Fitzpatrick. On this Christmas Eve, our guest is football and basketball beat writer Orion Tsang from the Detroit Free Press. First, a few of my thoughts before he joins us on our game day segment. I'm recording this on the 23rd for release on Christmas Eve, so who knows what will happen in the next few hours. Don Brown was released on Tuesday, no surprise, as it was obvious change was needed. Don has been an outstanding coach at every stop in his career. His overall body of work here at Michigan was, for the most part, exceptional. I'm not sure what happened with his defense this year, and I'm not sure if he can explain what led to the collapse. These things do happen, though, and it is time to move on. The Harbaugh extension is on the table, but whether he accepts or moves on is still very unclear. Again, these things are happening right now, and we could have a decision within hours. By the time this show airs, we just don't know. Whatever happens, it will be a busy winter with lots of news and interest surrounding the football program, so I hope you stay with us as we get into the new year. My guest today says that before the season, he thought Michigan would be lucky to end up 4-4. He never envisioned we'd end up 2-4 and be regressing each week. He also says the jury is still out on just how good Juwan Howard's team might be, but we'll have a better idea very soon. Beat writer Orion Tsang from the Detroit Free Press joins us next on our Christmas Eve edition of The Michigan Man. So stay with us. Here with us on our game day segment this week is Orion Tsang from the Detroit Free Press, who covers both Michigan football and basketball, so we will get to talk about both. Welcome to the show, Orion.
Good to be back, Mike. Happy holidays.
And happy holidays to you, sir. As we mentioned, you cover both Michigan football and basketball, so let's start with a little football talk. On Monday, I thought it was interesting the athletic department, Michigan athletic department, announced they would not play in a bowl game, which really is in some ways too bad because they really could have used those 15 extra practices that they get. But the announcement was not a surprise because a lot of teams are opting out, aren't they, Orion?
Yeah, I guess it's not a surprise just based on their COVID issues and their record. So it's not a surprise that they weren't invited. And like you said, a lot of teams are opting out even if they are invited or preemptively opting out at least. I think Jeff Hasley, the Boston College coach, put it best. Boston College is, I think, 5-4 or 6-5, and they opted out because Hasley said, in the past, you know, a bowl game was a reward for the hard work and achievement that a team accomplished during the season, right? But this year, you know, it's more of a reward to a lot of players to go home for the holidays and get a chance to spend some time with their families and friends. And that was his justification, you know, for having his team opt out of the bowl game. And I thought it makes sense. It is a weird year where, you know, the normal experience of a bowl game where it's fun and players get to hang out and do special activities, that's not really going to happen this year. So I certainly agree with his decision.
I think we all do, and we all understand it has been a crazy year. So the option to, you know, go home and visit family, this is understood. On the other front that we're all focusing on, Jim Harbaugh, of course, there's no news. Things could change at any time, but he and Ward Manuel met last week, and it was reportedly a 4 or 5 hour session. You would think it would be in everyone's best interest to get this thing settled as soon as possible, wouldn't you, Orion?
Yeah, just based on the timeline, Michigan, there are several assistant coaches whose contracts will be up in January, who end in January. And obviously, every year, there's been staff turnover to some extent. So, you know, assuming they need to hire some assistants, you know, this situation will have to be resolved to keep them in the mix for assistants they may want to hire. You know, I mean, all the schools will be trying to hire assistants too. So, you know, it could be a detriment to Michigan's ability to hire coaches. And then obviously, the same thing goes for recruiting, you know, leading into the February signing period, if Michigan does want to land recruits or add transfers to the portal. I mean, this is another thing that could be a detriment to them if it's not resolved as soon as possible.
Right. So let's just say, for conversation, the contract gets finalized in the next week or two, Orion. I think observers inside and outside the program
have weighed in on this, and some expect there will be a lot of staff changes. Others think no, just maybe a few, or just tweak the coaching staff. Really, anything is possible, isn't it?
Yeah, I think it's safe to assume that, you know, if Jim does come back, there are going to be some changes, I think. And it's necessary, you know. I mean, you know, when you had the season like they did, where not only they finished with a losing record, but they weren't competitive in some games. You know, you've got to look and be introspective and think of what went wrong. And, you know, I think he will do that. He has never been afraid to make changes on the staff. And I think that will happen again this offseason if he does return.
Well, Orion, when the season started, we knew this Michigan team was one of the youngest in college football, but they still had enough talent to be much better than they were in the end. And, you know, I try to look back over the six games and figure this out, but where do you think the season started to come off the rails for this team?
I think it all started with the Michigan State game, right? I mean, they looked confident at Minnesota. And we all know, you know, Minnesota wasn't very good. But I think the way that Michigan lost that Michigan State game, I think that just sort of spiraled them out of control. They lost all their confidence. And it seems like they just sort of lost the ability to fight and to win, you know, like to come back from adversity, to come back from failing a deficit. I mean, they just really struggled with that going forward after that Michigan State game. It seemed to really jolt them. I think that's the point where, you know, everything went wrong. And I think, you know, if they had won that game, you know, and finished 3-3 or whatever, or even 2-4, I don't think there would have been as much scrutiny or criticism of the team. I mean, that, you know, this fan base, I mean, they really can't take or stomach losing to Michigan State, especially when they are perceived to be the superior team, even if that was, you know, incorrect. I think the entire season really turned after that game.
No, absolutely. I agree. And, you know, if we're being honest and we look back at the previews at the beginning of the season, and that was expecting we would play an 8-game schedule, a lot of writers nationally and locally said, you know, this team might be 4-4. It could be a little bit better, but 4-4 would be what a lot of people thought the record would be in the end. I think the unhappiness is just how the team went south after that Michigan State game.
Yeah, I think we're going to go 4-4 entering the season because I thought that this team didn't have as much experience as, you know, others. It was one of the least experienced teams in the nation. When you look at the recruiting ranking, Michigan, you know, is arguably, quote-unquote, more talented than most of the teams in the Big Ten. But when you talk about just in the context of Michigan itself, there was less NFL talent on its roster than on previous Michigan teams. And I thought that would come into play. And it certainly did. And obviously, they had a really unlucky year with attrition, a couple opt-outs, right? You know, they had pretty much every high-level contributor or prospect with NFL potential got hurt at some point this season. So that did not help them at all either. But obviously, you look at the games, you can't really say that, you know, even if they had been healthy, that they would have done that well. You know, they just seemed out of sorts ever since that first week. You know, they looked fine at Minnesota, played well, played hard, played smart football for the most part. And then after that, you know, we didn't really see that team again the rest of the season, even in the other win at Rutgers. That was not a clean win.
The player that there was so much hype about before the season, and, you know, it wasn't his fault there was this much hype, but Joe Milton, and he looked very, very good in the opener. But as the weeks progressed, you could tell his confidence was taking a hit. And, you know, from what we hear, he was injured, too.
That's another one where, you know, I think the offensive line is brand new. Receivers, you know, brand new. Quarterback, brand new. Offense as a whole, you know, just was out of sync for much of the season. It was super young. I think what will be most disappointing to fans is that, you know, there are certainly opportunities where it seemed like the offense just didn't capitalize on what was in front of them. You know, you talk about all the short yardage situations that have failed, 3rd-and-1, 4th-and-1, all those situations. And then you talk about the run game, which is inconsistent on and off, pass game, some flashes there, but never consistent. You know, I think it sort of sums up, Joe's season sort of sums up the offense season as a whole. You know, there are flashes, but never could quite put it all together.
Well, no, and the offense struggled as a unit this season, Orion, and that's, you know, all the postmortems are being done right now, and people are trying to pinpoint, was it the offensive line, was it the receivers, was it shuffling too many backs, and was it the offensive game planning? I think you could check each one of those off. It was just a total system failure, wasn't it, on offense?
It was just a different, I think, different situation from last year. I mean, you talk about last year, I don't want to harp on it too much, but you look at the experience on that team. I mean,
yeah,
the offensive line, 4 of those guys went to the NFL after season. I mean, they were veterans that played together, multi-year starters. I mean, you had experience at receiver. You know, you have experience at quarterback with the multi-year starter there. I think all of that matters in college football, especially during this weird year, you know, when Michigan didn't get spring practices. They had an abbreviated offseason, fewer workouts than normal. I think experience plays a huge factor. You know, you look at teams like Notre Dame or Northwestern, it seemed like those teams were filled with veterans and seniors, and I think that really helps. It really pays off in a year like this. And Michigan just didn't have that.
Well, and on the other side of the ball, the defense, you know, they were just bad all year, and you can take your pick. Injuries, youth, schematics, lack of confidence, whatever was going on. I think in my lifetime, that was the hardest Michigan defense to watch.
That's the one where it's a little more inexplainable because, you know, they returned more pieces on defense and offense, and it just really completely fell apart. I think it starts from the Michigan State game. I think that killed the defense's confidence, especially in pass coverage. I mean, they were getting bombs for deep balls the entire time. And I think going forward, you know, they tried to fix it. They tried to play more zone coverage. They tried to play different schemes, and it just didn't really work out. And obviously, the injuries to Aiden Hutchinson and Quiddy Pay at Indiana didn't help either. You know, the defense's downturn, I think, is probably one of the more disconcerting things to take away from a season, just because the defense had played at such a high level all the previous few years, and to see it take such a large step back, that was definitely surprising to many. I thought it wouldn't be as good as it had been in the past, but I did not foresee, you know, the defense being as bad as it was, for sure.
No, and, you know, and now that the season is over, Orion, I think I, like many other Michigan fans, are asking ourselves, how did we get to this point in the sixth year of the Harbaugh regime? Are we being overly critical of this team, given their youth and the COVID environment they played under this year?
I think it's a blend of both. I think that it is very difficult for any team not named Clemson, Alabama, or Ohio State to reload, especially, you know, when you look at just how many players Michigan lost from last year. I mean, counting to, you know, NFL draft attrition, graduation, and then injuries and opt-outs. I mean, the number was enormous. They lost basically every single high-level contributor, every single significant contributor. That's a big deal. I mean, like I said, if you're not named Clemson, Alabama, Ohio State, and you're thrust into that situation, chances are you're going to struggle. At the same time, I think you have to ask, you know, why was this program so disorganized or seemingly so disorganized in year six? You know, I think it's fair to ask why they were in this position in the first place, you know, where they were so vulnerable and so inexperienced. That's a reflection of the recruiting, the development of losing a lot of players to the portal or to transfer. I mean, it all adds up. And I think that there's no reason they should have been that bad. You know, they could have been more competitive. I think the two things are, for me, one, going back to the Michigan State game, I mean, that's probably a game where you just can't lose that game. And then the Wisconsin game, losing 49-11. I mean, Wisconsin is not that good to beat like that. In some ways, this is predictable, and there's something they could have really done about the situation. And on the other hand, you know, they put themselves in here in the first place. So when you look at the past few years leading up to this, you know, there are some things they maybe could have done during that time to change this current situation.
Well, a final thought on the football situation before we talk about hoops, but the early signing period was last week, and, you know, considering how the season went and the fact Jim Harbaugh's future is in question, in the end it was a pretty good class, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I thought they did a better job than expected, if we're being honest, of holding up the class. You know, they entered a day with 21 commitments, and then they signed 19 of those 21. Then they added another, so they ended up with 20. You know, all things considered, that's a pretty high retention rate, considering, you know, all this uncertainty surrounding the program. And I'm sure other teams were trying to flip Michigan's guys. And they even added a high-level prospect on signing day with Donovan Edwards, a top 50 running back from West Bloomfield. So all in all, I mean, I think they did a solid job. At the same time, when you look at the class, it's pretty heavily tilted towards the offensive side of the ball. So you're probably going to need to find more contributors on defense somehow, either through, you know, the portal or during the rest of the recruiting period. So, you know, a solid job, but it didn't quite answer, you know, all the questions that we had about this team and how they can turn things around.
Okay, so let's get our minds off football. We'll have plenty of that to talk about in the coming months, I'm sure. But, Michigan basketball has got it going right now, 6-0 as of this week, Orion, and they have looked surprisingly good to me, especially freshman center Hunter Dickinson. This kid came right on campus and looks like a difference maker already, doesn't he?
Yeah, I think you could say he's been the most consistent player on this year's team. I mean, yeah, he scored in double digits every time, I believe. He's averaging the most points on the team, most rebounds. I mean, he's, every time you call upon him, he is dependable. And I think that's, again, I think that's hugely important for this year's team, just because there's no Xavier Simpson. You know, like that was just like the backbone of last year's offense. You know, this year there's a lot of different guys who handle the ball, a lot of different guys who get their chance to make plays. But I think every time they pass the ball to Hunter down low, every time they set him in the post for post up possession, I think he's done well. And I think that's key for an offense that's still trying to figure out who can rely on, you know, what it can do. I think having the option to give the ball to Hunter down low, I think that's been really key for them.
And one thing we've seen through these first six games is a lot of people getting rotated into the game. So it looks like this is a fairly deep team with COVID and a long season ahead of you. This year, especially this year, it really is good to at least be able to go deep, isn't it?
Yeah, I would agree. I think that was probably some of the same thinking behind this extended rotation early on. I think he showed last year that he's more conventional in terms of his rotation and wanting to play maybe 7 to 8 guys a night. Well, you know, which makes sense. You want to play your best guys, get them on the floor as often as possible. But I think this year he was able to get some guys important minutes early. You know, guys like Terrence Williams, Zeb Jackson, that could help down the line. You never know. But right now, I think there is a clear pecking order in terms of the rotation and who they will be playing going forward. But like you said, it does help that some of those other guys got some time early on.
Well, we just talked about Hunter Dickinson, what an impact he's been on both ends of the floor for us. But others we expect to lead the way. Isaiah Livers, you know, when he came back, we expect big things. And being a leader from his Isaiah, and he's looked pretty good so far.
Yeah, they've given him some more leeway, some more responsibilities with the ball. I think he's handled it pretty well for the most part. More assists. I think he shot the ball very well. He's making more plays with the ball handler, which is promising. I think it should be mentioned, though, that, you know, their wings, Isaiah and Franz, they've also had some off nights, some nights where they weren't that consistent or, you know, weren't that present on the box score. I think they could use more consistency from those guys. I think they rely on them a lot on offense. And they play good defense, don't get me wrong. But I think more consistent presence on offense would help the team going forward. That's just my opinion. Obviously, they're still undefeated, but, you know, I think you need those guys to really step up and be the type of contributors to offense that many anticipated heading into this season.
Yeah, and I agree with you. I think Isaiah Livers is going to have a great senior season. Wagner concerns me a bit. It's only been six games, so, I mean, I don't want to get too crazy about it, but he just sort of hasn't found his rhythm yet, has he?
He is, I think, probably the most well-rounded player on the team. I think this is evident even last year, where he just seems to know where to be on court. You can tell he just knows how to play the game. I mean, he's always in the right spot. He knows how to space the floor. He knows how to impact the game on defense, away from the ball, on the ball. Super lengthy. He's got a lot of length to him, and that really impacts opposing teams. And then offense, you know, he's really good at driving the ball. I think the one thing I've been surprised by is his 3-point shooting. I think he was hailed as a really good 3-point shooter coming into college, and he hasn't quite been that. You know, he's been a very good player. I think the thing, though, this season is that he's going from a complimentary role in offense last year to becoming more of the man this year. And I think that there are some times where he might be pressing, you know, where he gets the ball and it seems like he's already determined that he's going to drive it and try to score. We've seen him draw some charges due to that. He's turned the ball over a decent amount this season. And I think he'll have to, when he goes back and watches the film, I think that's one thing he'll notice. You know, he'll have to vary some of those drives, those straight line drives, with maybe passing it or, you know, being less aggressive or obvious with his intentions of going to the rim. But I think that's something that he'll improve on throughout the season. I mean, I do expect him to get better on offense going forward. But I think, like some of the other players, he has to adjust to not having Xavier Simpson, you know, handling the ball, making plays. So it's a work in progress.
Tim McCormick, former Michigan great Tim McCormick, is an analyst now, TV analyst, and he made that point last week that he said, I'm not so worried about Franz Wagner. He said he's someone who needs the ball in certain places, and Xavier Simpson knew exactly where to get him the ball. And Mike Smith, who is the Columbia transfer, who is at point and I think playing very, very good basketball, is still in the process of learning about his teammates and how to mesh, isn't he?
Yeah, he is. I think he's been surprisingly effective to me. Don't get me wrong, he's a good player, but everyone has questions, you know, when you're moving from the Ivy League to the Big Ten. And obviously, you know, he's only played one Big Ten game so far, but I think the signs are promising even before that. I think the one thing for him is, you know, picking his spots offensively. I think it's still, you can tell that some of the guys are still tentative with, you know, when to shoot, when to go try to get theirs. On offense, it's a very egalitarian system, and I think it's good. I mean, I don't want it to sound like I'm criticizing the offense too much, because the offense is still, it's played really well this season, considering, you know, who they lost from last year. I just think it seems apparent to me that some guys are still figuring out their roles in the offense.
Yeah.
He's been a really good passer, but he hasn't shot the ball as well as I anticipated. And I think there's some times, you know, when he can look to make the play for himself and then try to score instead of passing the ball, spreading it out. So, again, he's off to a really good start. That's one of the things I'm watching as he gets the hard Big Ten players, whether he can keep it up.
Well, as we mentioned, the bench play has been surprisingly good so far this year. And one of the reasons is the work of another grad transfer who I have to say I did not know that much about, Chandi Brown, who came over from Wake Forest. What do you think of his contribution to the team so far?
I think he's fit in really well. He's been a really, really good 3-and-D wing. I think offensively, he excels, you know, in catch-and-shoot situations, which, again, I did not anticipate based on his stats from last year. But he's been pretty good at that role this year. And then on defense, you know, he's been everywhere. I mean, he's guarded different positions, multiple positions. He isn't as, like, long as someone like Franz, but he's quick enough to stay in front of smaller players. He's built enough to hold his ground against bigger players. He's just a really good defender. I mean, I think that matters a lot. You've seen, you know, how close Big Ten games are, and sometimes you just need to stop. And I think he's one of the reasons why they were able to pull out that win against Penn State. You know, they were able to shut down Penn State offensively. And you know, on a night where Michigan's offense didn't play that well, that made a difference.
I just love what we're getting from him off the bench. So that's very positive. As we've mentioned, and we all know, Austin Davis is out, and we're not sure for how long yet. So until he comes back, Hunter Dickinson, he needs to get off the floor some. I think he's been getting 28, almost 30 minutes a game right now. Brandon Johns is getting more of an opportunity right now, and he really needs to step it up, doesn't he?
Yeah, he struggled in the last game, I think, with the turnovers. But before that, I think he was carving out a pretty solid role for himself. Small ball center, back up four. I think he was playing well in the limited time he got. I mean, it's hard to get in a rhythm like that, right? But I think that he was providing a lot of energy on both ends of the court. Obviously, he's always been talented in terms of his athleticism, his ability to shoot the ball, to just be out there and impact the game, offensively rebounding, defensive rebounding. I mean, I just think that it's a weird spot for him because they have a lot of guys ahead of him, you know, who are at his positions, and he still has to try to find a way to make an impact in the limited time he does get. And I think he's doing that. You know, I think he's not there yet, but he's becoming more consistent than he was in last year, I think, in terms of being able to make an impact every time he's on the floor.
Yeah, he's one of those guys that's really, since he's arrived, that his talent is so tantalizing that you think, okay, one of these days, one of these series of games, he's going to put it together. But he's just been in and out. Maybe this will be the year he gets consistency.
Yeah, I think that's a really good way to put it. I mean, he is obviously a very talented player, but he just needs to be able to do it consistently on a consistent basis. And he didn't really do that as a freshman. I mean, you could say he didn't get an opportunity to do that, but you know, the counter argument would be he didn't earn the opportunity to do that. Last year, you know, was hot and cold. Sometimes looked like the best player on the floor for both teams, and then sometimes looks like he didn't belong in a court either. I think this year it's more, there's less variation. You know, obviously he's coming off probably his worst game of the season against Penn State. Before that, I think he was smoothing out his play, leveling it out, and becoming more of a consistent presence on the court. So, I mean, tough for him because, you know, he's not a starter, and, you know, it might help him even more if he was getting more minutes, but you know, you've got to make do with what you get, and I think he's on his way to doing that this year.
Well, I'm hoping we get Austin Davis back sooner than later. I mean, I just love what he brings to the game, whether it's off the bench or whether he's starting. But as far as his injury, I guess I haven't seen anything specifically as to what it is or even a time frame when he's expected back, Orion.
Yeah, there's been nothing on that front. Obviously, tough situation for him because he's a fifth-year senior, came back and got hurt. I think they're doing a good job of trying to figure things out, though, because obviously he was a starting center, played fewer minutes than Dickinson, but still an important member of the rotation. I think they pivoted Brandon Johns as a backup center. Terrence Williams got some time, too. Going smaller, I think, was necessary in the wake of that injury. I think that's what they've leaned to. And I think it's working well for them. Obviously, they'd like to get him back as soon as possible, but right now, I think they're making the best of the situation. Obviously, it's really difficult for Austin to lose out on such a large portion of his senior season like that. So you definitely hope that he's able to recover soon.
Well, at this point, we are 1-0 in Big Ten play, as we all know, 6-0 overall, and we're going to hook up with Nebraska on Christmas Day down there in Lincoln. No easy games, as we're seeing in the Big Ten. It's really been that way for a long time, but this year looks, again, grueling. But if we bring our A game on Christmas Day, I think Michigan is a tough matchup for the Huskers, don't you?
Yeah, I think so, too. I think you say that for most Big Ten teams.
Yeah.
That they're a tough matchup for Nebraska. I think they will be good eventually, but I think Hoiberg's is trying to get his guys in there right now. It's a pretty tough rebuilding job. But again, it's on the road. There's no crowd at all, but I think road games are still tough. And like you said, every game in the Big Ten will be a battle. So definitely an opponent that Michigan can't overlook. It's a weird situation because they are playing on Christmas. So maybe there's more distractions than usual just because you're thinking about, you want to be with family instead of being in Nebraska. So we'll see. I think those first few minutes of the game, it will be pretty insightful into what Michigan's done during these past 12 days and, where the players' minds are at. Because this is a tough situation, This is during holiday season, and they drew the short straw in having to go to Nebraska on Christmas Day. So I'm definitely interested to see how Michigan starts that game, for sure.
The Big Ten is so loaded up this year, as we've mentioned. I mean, you just look at what they've done against outside competition. It's been very impressive. But when you look at this Michigan team, and again, this probably isn't a fair question, six games into a weird season already, but is it too early to know or even make a guess as to whether Michigan is an upper-tier team in the conference or maybe just a middle-of-the-pack club?
They're looking pretty good, but I want to wait because, their non-conference schedule obviously wasn't very imposing. I still say that this is a three-team race at the top between, like, four-team race. I'll say four-team race between Wisconsin, Illinois, Iowa, and Michigan State. I still believe Michigan State's going to be up there at the end of the season. Michigan, when they play to their full potential, looks like a team that could contend when everything's clicking, when those open threes are falling, when open shots are falling, and the defense is clamping down. I mean, I think they look as good as any other team in the country. It's just about bringing those moments and putting them together throughout the course of the game instead of having it happen like once or twice during the game. It's all about consistency. I think that if they're able to establish more consistency over the course of the season, then yes, I could see them becoming a Big Ten competitor, contender. But as of right now, I have to put them in that second tier. I want to see more from them, and I just think some of those other teams, have more firepower than Michigan, I guess, is what I'll say. Like if you're looking at Wisconsin, I mean, they brought back four or five seniors from a team that already won the Big Ten. Illinois, they have a couple NBA caliber prospects, and then Iowa, that offense is something else, So I'm in a wait and see mode when it comes to declaring Michigan as a contender with those teams.
Well, final question for you today, Orion, before we let you get away. We saw what COVID did to Michigan football and really much of college football for that matter in the last months. How it impacts this college basketball season really is the major story to watch, isn't it?
Yeah, you just got to be safe and just some semblance of luck. I'd have to imagine that comes with not getting it. They seem to have done a pretty good job of being safe and responsible, and obviously hope their good fortune continues, but a lot of teams have already dealt with this in some way or some fashion, with the people in the program getting it, having to pause or shut down, cancel games. At this point, you're just waiting to see how it impacts Michigan's season. They've already had one game canceled because their opponent got it. We'll see what happens going forward. It's not going to be an easy year. Not going to be a normal year. I think you've already seen that from college football and from the early portion of the college basketball season. So we'll see, fingers crossed that they don't have an outbreak. I just think that it'll be tough to avoid given what you've seen with other programs, other teams across the nation.
Oh, absolutely. I agree. But it's at least is good to have college basketball back. And let's keep our fingers crossed with the vaccine out there. And even though it won't get to us in that age group until much later in the year, let's just hope we have a long season and get as many games in as possible. So we shall see. With us today on our game day segment has been Orion Tsang from the Detroit Free Press, who covers both football and basketball for the University of Michigan. Orion, always a pleasure to have you on the show, and we wish you and yours a very Merry Christmas and a Happy Holidays, and we look forward in the next year getting you back on, especially this winter, talking Michigan hoops.
Same to you, Mike. Always good to be on, and Happy Holidays to you and your family.
Quick Hits is next as we wrap it up for another week here on The Michigan Man on Wolverine Sports Radio, a member of the vSporto Network and in partnership with SB Nation's Maize and Brew. On Quick Hits today, basketball is in action tomorrow at Nebraska in a very rare Christmas Day game. We are 6-0 overall, 1-0 in the Big Ten. Women's basketball has been forced to cancel their last two games because of COVID concerns on the team. There is no word as to how extensive the problem is. Once again, I want to take a minute to wish each and every one of you a very merry and safe Christmas. It has been a hard year for so many of you, I know that. Even gathering with family and friends at this joyous time of the year is out of the question for many of us. We've survived a difficult 2020, and we can only hope and pray the coming year will be better for all of us, and I think it will be. I will be back next week with our final show of this very forgettable year with all the latest news on Michigan athletics. So make sure you join me. I'm your host, Mike Fitzpatrick. Again, I wish each and every one of you a very Merry Christmas. Have a great Wolverine week, everyone. Until we meet again, take care, and as always, go blue. Thanks for joining us today on The Michigan Man, here on Wolverine Sports Radio, a member of the VSporto Network, and in partnership with SB Nation's Maize and Brew. Our listener lines are open 24-7 for your calls at 313-263-4842. That's 313-263-4842. Or email us at themichiganmanpodcast@yahoo.com. That's themichiganmanpodcast@yahoo.com. The Michigan Man Podcast is produced at the studios of Robin Lynn Productions, Allen Park, Michigan, and is not affiliated with the University of Michigan. Go Blue!